Good day, everyone. So for today's discussion, we're going to talk about virology. So in this PowerPoint presentation, I'm going to discuss introduction about virology. So short definition of viruses, classification of viruses, replication, viral replication. Also, I'm going to talk about mechanism of viral disease. And last, laboratory diagnosis of viruses. So to begin with, let's define, no, and discuss the properties of viruses. So generally, viruses are considered to be filterable agents. So they were first described as filterable agents because of their small size. So the virus, no, allows them to pass through filters designed to retain bacteria. Viruses are also considered as obligate intracellular parasites. So unlike most bacteria class, fungi, and some protozoans, so viruses are obligate intracellular parasites because they are dependent on biochemical machinery of the host cell for them to replicate. Viruses also cannot make energy or proteins, so they are very dependent on the host. So viruses lack the capacity to make energy or substrate and cannot make their own proteins and cannot replicate their genome independently of the host cell. To use the cell's biosynthetic machinery, the virus must be adapted to the biochemical rules of the cell. So the virus must be able to use cell processes to produce their components like viral messenger RNA, proteins, and identical copies of the genome. So viruses, also genomes class, may be RNA or DNA, but not both. Okay, so the simplest viruses consist of a genome of deoxyribonucleic acid or DNA or ribonucleic acid packaged in a protective shell protein for some viruses like membranes. Viruses also have naked capsid or an envelope morphology. So that's one of characteristics, no, of viruses. And last, viral components are assembled and do not replicate by division. So reproduction of viruses class occurs by assembly of individual components rather than binary fission, which is the usual cell division of your bacteria. So the knowledge and structures class of viruses and genetic, like type of structure of nucleic acid, features of virus provides insight of how virus replicates, spread, and cause, no, of disease. Okay, so now let's discuss the means of classification and naming of the virus. So in classifying viruses class, there are certain factors, no, or categories being followed. So for example, structure and biochemical characteristics. So for the structure, it's according to the size, the morphology, whether the virus contains capsid or envelope, and the nucleic acid. So whether the virus is an RNA type of a virus or a DNA type of virus. So for example, picorna. Picorna clouds comes from a Greek word pico, which means small, the RNA there, which means small RNA virus. Okay? Also, tuga virus, tuga, which means mantle, from a Greek word mantle, which means membrane envelope, no, surrounding the virus. So therefore, toga virus is an envelope type of virus. Aside from the structure, biochemical characteristics also is one of the classification of naming the virus. Disease, okay, like encephalitis and hepatitis. So for example, hepatitis, which means the liver, no, is the target tissue of the virus. Also, means of transmission, like your arbovirus, which are your arthropod-borne viruses, which is spread by vectors, host cell range, so the animals, human, mouse, bird, and plant bacteria, and tissue or organ. Okay, like for example, adenovirus and enterovirus. So adenovirus, like adenoids, and enterovirus, meaning enteric site. So these refers to the body site which these virus were first isolated. Okay, so as mentioned earlier, viruses are classified in according to nucleic acid. Okay, so there are viruses exist either DNA or RNA type of virus. So let's discuss first DNA viruses. So DNA viruses are further classified into envelope type and naked capsid, meaning they don't have envelope, they don't have a membrane. Okay, so envelopes includes your pox virus, herpes viridae, and hepatitis viridae family. Your naked or naked capsid viruses includes your polyoma, papilloma, adenoviruses, and parvo viruses. So the genomics for your DNA viruses is happy. So all DNA viruses are happy. So HHA, P, 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 Y. The Y there is just an additional. So, all of these viruses, except for Farbo class, are double-stranded DNA viruses, while your Farbo virus is a single-stranded DNA viruses. So, here, the table here shows you the different family of DNA viruses and their common members of viruses. Okay, so I'll be discussing this on a separate slide. So here is just a summary of the genome, the virion properties, as well as the nature, if it's double stranded DNA or single-stranded RNA, linear, circular type of viruses. Okay, so if you notice, pox is the largest DNA virus, while Farboviridae is the smallest DNA viruses. And your Farboviridae is also the only single-stranded DNA, okay, virus. The rest are double-stranded. So for that, let's summarize it. So all DNA viruses class are envelope except for pap smear. Pap smear stands for Farbo, Adeno, Papilloma, and Polyoma viruses. Okay. Then all DNA viruses are double-stranded except for your Farbo virus, which because your Farbo virus is a single-stranded DNA. All DNA viruses are linear except for POPA. POPA stands for polyoma, hepatna, and papilloma virus. All DNA viruses have icosahedral capsid except for pox virus because your pox virus class has a complex form of the membrane. Then all DNA viruses replicates in the nucleus except for pox because your pox virus class replicates in the cytoplasm because it carries its own dependent RNA polymerase. Okay, so here, this is the RNA viruses, their genome structure, and their morphology. So the viral families are determined class by the structure of the genome and the morphology of the virion. So RNA viruses are classified into positive sense RNA or negative sense RNA. Okay, so it is also further classified into naked type or envelope type. So you have their positive sense, naked RNA viruses, Picorna, Calici, Hepi, and Astro. For your envelope type, you have your Togaviridae, Flaviviridae, and coronavirus. Your negative sense RNA, you have your Rhabdo, Philo, Orthomyxo, Paramyxo, Bunya, and Arena. You have their double capsid, you have your Rioviridae, and your envelope type positive sense RNA. Okay, you have there your retrovirus. So here is the table, class, just the same with your DNA viruses a while ago. You have there the family and the members of the viruses. So the members of the viruses, class, are the common, no, member, common viruses under each family. So I will also be discussing this on a separate slide, each of the viruses. Okay, so the same. The table here also shows you the shape of the virion, the size, whether it's envelope or naked naked type of viruses, and if it is positive sense or negative sense RNA, and if it's double-stranded or single-stranded type. So let's summarize the this table. So for RNA, all RNA viruses, class, are envelope except for the naked CPR plus H or your PRC examination. So PRC stands for Picorna, Rio, Calici, plus herpes virus. Okay, so these viruses, class, are naked type of viruses. The rest are envelope type of viruses. And all RNA viruses are single-stranded RNA except for your reovirus, okay? Because the reovirus is a double-stranded RNA type. All RNA viruses are arcosahedral capsids except for few helical viruses like the mnemonics is a helix. A there stands for arena viruses. The H there stands for the rhabdoviruses. The E stands for Emperor's Wears Corona, okay, virus. The L there, class, stands for all envelope RNA that has an L in the third letter of their names. Like, for example, your Delta virus and your filovirus. But your calicivirus, class, is different because your calicivirus is a naked virus. Although it has an L on its third third letter of the name, but remember the rule is only limited to the envelope RNA, but your calcivirus is a naked type RNA, so therefore it has an icosahedral capsid. Okay, your Y if there is in the fourth letter of their names, and the only RNA virus, class, that has Y on the fourth letter is your Bunya virus. And X is the virus that had X in their name, like your Orthomyxo and your Paramyxo viruses. Also, all RNA, class, are linear except the three circular ones, your Arena, your Bunya, and your Delta virus. Arena, okay, remember, arena are always round. Bunya, the word bunions, which are also round. And delta, okay, from the Greek letter number 6, which is also round. Some people, class, may point out that corona is also round. But remember, class, your corona, okay, have linear, okay? Diba? Yung crown, meron siyang lines, no, when we drew, illustrate it. So, it's different from the other three. Okay? Segmented RNA viruses, okay, you have there the mnemonics, ROBA, which means robot pieces. The ROBA stands for Rioviruses, Orthomyxoviruses, Bunya viruses, and Arena viruses. So these four viruses, class, are segmented type of RNA. And last, all RNA viruses have replicate in the cytoplasm except for your orthomyxoviruses and your retroviruses because they contain their own DNA polymerase. Okay, so they do not require any more help from the nucleus. So, the virion class, okay, is the virus particle that consists of a nucleic acid genome packaged into a protein coat called capsid, okay, or a membrane called envelope. The virion may also contain certain essential or accessory enzymes or other proteins to facilitate initial replication in the cell. So your capsid or nucleic acid binding proteins may associate with the genome to form a nucleocapsid, which may be the same as the virion or surrounded by an envelope. So the genome inside class may consist either RNA or DNA type of viruses. And again, the DNA can be single-stranded or double-stranded or linear or circular, while the RNA can either be positive sense like messenger RNA or negative sense analogous to photographic negative. Okay, or double-stranded positive or negative sense or ambisense containing positive and negative regions of RNA attached end to end. So the RNA genome may also be segmented into pieces, which piece including one or more genes, just like your orthomyxoviruses. Okay. Similarly, the larger genome, the more information genes it can carry, the larger capsid or envelope structure required contained in the genome. So the outer layer class of the virion is called your capsid or your envelope. So these structures are the package or protection and delivery vehicle during transmission of the virus from one host to another or for spread within the host to the target cell. So the surface structures class of capsid and envelopes mediates the interaction of the virus with the target through viral attachment proteins or your BAP, okay, or structures. Removal or disruption of the outer package inactivates the virus. So antibodies generated against the BAP prevents the virus infection. That is why there are some antibodies class that are directed to your viral attachments proteins. So here on the picture, the structure of a naked capsid icosahedral virus and an envelope viruses at the bottom. On the other hand, this is a nucleocapsid or a helical ribonucleocapsid and helical nucleocapsid are always enveloped for human viruses. So this is just a summary of the components class and the properties, no, as well as the consequences of a naked and envelope virus. Okay, in summary, naked capsid class is rigid structure able to withstand harsh environmental conditions like soccer ball. Naked capsid viruses also have tough exterior and generally resistant to drying, acid, and detergents, including acid and bile of the enteric tract. Many of these viruses class under naked capsid are transmitted by fecal oral route and can endure transmission even class in the sewage. While envelope viruses class, okay, the envelope is a membrane composed of lipids, proteins and glycoproteins. So the membranous structure of the envelope class can be maintained only in aqueous solutions. It is readily disrupted class by drying, acidic conditions, detergents, and solvents such as ether, which results in activations to the virus. So as a result, envelope viruses class must remain wet and generally transmitted in fluids, respiratory droplets, blood, and tissue. Most cannot survive in harsh conditions of the gastrointestinal tract. So again, your nucleocapsid withstand no acid, okay, and this your nucleocapsid viruses are usually transmitted by a fecal oral route, while your envelope class cannot withstand harsh environments, so usually they are transmitted in fluids. So this is a general scheme of viral replication. So from recognition to lysis or release, okay? So the major steps class in viral replication are the same for all type of viruses. So as mentioned, viruses class are very dependent on the host. So the cell or the host cell class acts as a factory providing substrates, energy, as well as machinery necessary for the synthesis of viral proteins and replication of the genome. So processes class not provided by the host cell must be encoded in the genome of the virus. So the manner in which each virus accomplishes these following steps class and overcomes the cell biochemical limitation is different for different structure of the genome and the virion. So envelope type of viruses may also enter class directly by attachment and penetration, but will end the same with most of the viruses. So it will also have their assembly and cell release. So if you notice, antiviral agents are written in magenta, and these are written on each steps of the viral replication. So therefore, these drugs will act on these particular steps, okay, or process. So let's start with recognition and attachments of target cell. So the receptors of the virus on the cell class may be proteins or carbohydrates on glycoproteins or glycolipids. So attachments refers to the interaction class of a virion with a specific receptor site on the cell surface. As mentioned, the binding of the virus attachments protein or structure on the surface of the virion's capsid to receptors of the cell initially determine which cells can be infected by the virus. So example of viral attachments includes rhinovirus, so it attached to BP1, BP2 or BP3 complex, your adenovirus attached to a fiber protein, your influenza A virus attached to hemagglutinin glycoprotein, your measles virus attached to your H glycoprotein, and your HIV attached to GP120. Viruses that binds to the receptors also express no specific cell types may be restricted to certain species like human or mouse or specific cell type. The susceptibility target defines the tissue tropism. Okay, so your Epstein-Barr virus class, viral receptors are your C3d, which is the target cell, no, of your EBV is your B cell. Your HIV viral receptor is your CD4, which is the target cell is your T helper cells. Your influenza A virus, the viral receptor is the sialic acid. which is that target cell receptor is your respiratory epithelial cell, and your B19 parvovirus, the viral receptor is your erythrocyte P antigen, which binds to the globocide, no, a blood group P antigen expressed in the erythroid precursor cell. So for penetration, after binding, the virus particle class is taken up inside the cell. So this step is referred to as penetration or engulfment. So in some systems, like your DNA viruses, this is accomplished by receptor-mediated endocytosis, which is a normal process used by cell for uptake of receptor-bound molecules, and these are accompanied by either hormones, your low-density lipoprotein, and your transferrin. So take note, most envelope viruses class enter the cell by receptor-mediated endocytosis or varophexis. So varophexis is the process where a virus attaches to the wall of a cell and it absorbs into a cell through phagocytosis. So common viruses class that requires receptor-mediated endocytosis, okay, are your picornaviruses, papilloma, and folioma viruses. Once the virus class is internalized, the nucleocapsid must be delivered to the site of replication within the cell, and the capsid or envelope is removed. So, the genome of the DNA viruses, except for poxviruses, must be delivered to the nucleus, whereas most RNA viruses remain in the cytoplasm. So, in short, the viral capsid class is removed and degraded by viral enzymes or host enzyme releasing viral genomic nucleic acid. So, that's the process of your uncoating. So, the uncoating process may be initiated by attachment to the receptor or promoted by an acidic environment or proteases found in an endosome or lysosomes. So, viruses may require acidic pH in the endosomes. The infectivity of the parental virus is lost at the uncoating stage. So, viruses are only infectious agents for which dissolution of the infecting agent is an obligatory step in the replicative pathway. So, viral nucleic acid replication. So, replication, after viral genome has been uncoated, transcription, translation of the viral genome is initiated. So, it is the stage of the viral replication class that differs greatly between DNA or RNA viruses with the opposite nucleic acid polarity. So, for the DNA viruses, usually the host cell proteins and enzymes to make addition DNA that is transcribed to messenger RNA, which is then used to direct protein synthesis. While your RNA viruses class usually use the RNA core as a template for synthesis of viral genomic RNA and messenger RNA. So the viral mRNA directs the host cell to synthesize viral enzymes and capsid proteins to assemble new variants. So for DNA viruses class usually direct no yung viral replication. But for your RNA viruses, it requires template muna. So, the replication of the viruses class generally, okay, involves synthesis of the viral messenger RNA. So, from the early genes, with the exception of their positive sense RNA, viral protein synthesis, possible assembly of the viral proteins, then viral genome replication mediated by early or regulatory proteins expression. So, the end process class of your viral replication culminates in the de novo synthesis of viral proteins and genome. So here is an example of retrovirus. No? There are retrovirus class is an exception to the common pattern of your RNA viruses. So retrovirus, for such as your HIV, have an RNA genome that must be reverse transcribed into DNA, which is then incorporated into the host cell genome. So to convert RNA, okay, to DNA, your retrovirus class must contain genes that encode the virus-specific enzymes reverse transcriptase, which then transcribe an RNA template to DNA. Then reverse transcription never occurs in uninfected host cells. So the needed enzymes reverse transcriptase is the only derived from the expression of viral genes within the infected host cell. After de novo synthesis of viral genome and proteins class, viral proteins now are packaged with a newly replicated viral genome into the new variants that are ready for release from the host cell. And this process is called maturation. So, variants assembly class is analogous to a three dimensional interlocking puzzles, no, that put itself together in a box. So the variant is built from a small, easily manufactured parts that enclose the genome in a functional package. So each part of the variant, remember, has a recognition structures that allows virus to form the appropriate protein to nucleic acid, and protein membrane interactions needed to assemble into a final structure. So, in assembly, it depends on the genome replication, okay? Whether it's naked or envelope type of viruses. So, the assembly process happens, if DNA virus, it happens in the nucleus, while the RNA viruses and pox viruses happens at the cytoplasm. So, capsid viruses class may assemble as empty structures called procapsid to be filled with a genome, like for example, your picorna viruses, or they may be assembled around the genome. Nucleocapsids, on other hand, like your retroviruses, your toga viruses class, and the negative sense RNA viruses assemble around the genome and are subsequently enclosed in an envelope. While the helical nucleocapsid of a negative strand RNA viruses includes the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase necessary for your mRNA synthesis in the target cell. For envelope viruses class, the newly synthesized and processed viral glycoproteins are delivered to cellular membranes via vesicular transport. Acquisition of envelopes occurs after association of the nucleic capsid with a viral glycoprotein containing regions of host cell membranes in the process called budding. So, most RNA viruses class no buds from the plasma membrane, and the virus is released from the infected cell at the same time without killing. Like for example, your flavivirus, coronavirus, and your bunyavirus. So the last process is variant release. So lysis and plasma membrane budding are efficient means of viral or variant release. So, viruses can be released class after cell lysis via exocytosis or via budding from the plasma membrane. So, lysis results in the death of an infected host cell, which these types of viruses referred to as cytolytic type of viruses. So there are different mechanisms on how your viruses release. For naked capsid viruses, they will be released after cell lysis. So most RNA viruses class buds from the plasma membrane release from the cell at the same time without killing. Your flavivirus, coronavirus, and bunyavirus class buds into your endoplasmic reticulum and your Golgi membrane and then release. While your herpes simplex virus assembles in the nucleus and buds into and out of the adjacent endoplasmic reticulum and then release. So we're done with viral replication. Now let's go to discussion of your properties of the different viruses. So let's start with your DNA viruses. So the table class is just a summary of the properties of DNA viruses, and I want you to read this. So let's just summarize this one. So the replication of the genome of simple DNA viruses like your parvoviruses, your polyomaviruses, and papillomaviruses class uses host DNA dependent DNA polymerase, whereas the larger or more complex viruses like your adenoviruses, your herpesviruses, and your pox viruses encode their own polymerase. So viral polymerases class are usually faster but less precise than host cell polymerase, causing higher mutation rate in the virus and providing a target for nucleotide analogs as antiviral drugs. HPADNA, on other hand, if you notice, HPADNA virus class replicates in a unique way because a larger than genome positive strand RNA copy is first synthesized by the cell's DNA dependent RNA polymerase and circularizes. Viral protein surrounds the RNA, which is a viral encoded RNA dependent DNA polymerase, or your reverse transcriptase enzyme in this virion core makes a negative strand DNA, and then the RNA is degraded. Positive strand DNA synthesis is initiated but stops when the genome and core are enveloped, yielding to a partial double-stranded circular DNA genome. So here, this is an example class of herpes simplex virus replication. So your herpes simplex virus class is a complex envelope DNA type of viruses. So the virus binds to a specific receptor and fuses within a cytoplasm, within the plasma membrane, rather, the nucleocapsid then delivers into the genome to the nucleus. Transcription, translation occurs in these three phases. You have the immediate, you have the early, and the late transcription, including the DNA-dependent and DNA polymerase, and the late proteins are structural and other proteins including viral capsids and glycoproteins. The genome is replicated before transcription of the late genes. Capsid proteins migrate into the nucleus, assemble into icosahedral capsids, and then filled with DNA genome. So here, the capsids filled with the genome buds through a nuclear and your endoplasmic reticulum membranes in the cytoplasm, which acquires tegument proteins and then acquire their envelope as they bud through the viral glycoprotein modified membranes of the trans-Golgi network. Then the virus is released via exocytosis or cell lysis. For RNA type of viruses, so these are the properties of RNA types of viruses. So RNA are labile and transient. RNA also are prone to mutations. Then the genome structures and polarity determines how viral messenger RNA is generated and proteins are processed. So do read these properties of your viral RNA. We'll talk about more of RNA viruses on the next slides or next presentation. So here, this is a replication of a picorna viruses. Picorna is a simple positive sense RNA. Okay, so one here, it is the interaction of the picorna viruses with the receptor on the cell surface defines the target cell and weakens the capsid. The number two here is the genome injected through the virion and across the cell membrane. Alternatively, the virion is endocytose here. The virion is endocytose and then the genome is released. On the third steps, the genome is used as messenger RNA for protein synthesis. One large polyprotein is translated in from the virion genome. Four, then the polyprotein is proteically cleaved into individual proteins including your RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. Five, macromolecular synthesis proceeds in a vesicle. So the RNA polymerase makes negative sense strand template from the genome and replicates the genome. A protein is a covalently attached to the 5N prime of the viral genome. And number six here, the structural proteins associate into a capsid structure. The genome then is then inserted. And then the virions are released through cell lysis. While here, this is an example of a rhabdovirus, a simple envelope negative sense RNA. So rhabdovirus class binds to the cell surface and then endocytose. The envelope fuses, okay, with the endosome's vesicle membrane to deliver a nucleocapsid to the cytoplasm. The virion must carry the polymerase, which produces 5 individual messenger RNA and a full length of positive sense RNA templates. Number four, the proteins are translated from the messenger RNA, including the 1 glycoprotein, which is a co-translationally glycosylated in the endoplasmic reticulum, processed in the Golgi apparatus, and then delivered to the cell membrane. The genome is replicated from the positive sense template and the NL and NS proteins associates with the genome to form nucleocapsid. The matrix and the matrix protein associates with the G protein modified membrane, which follows by assembly of the nucleocapsids. And then last, the virus buds from the cell in a bullet-shaped virion. Now let's go to mechanism of viral pathogenesis. So viruses class causes disease after they break through the natural protective barriers of the body. They also evade no immune controls and either kill the cells of an important tissues like brain or trigger an destructive immune and inflammatory response. So the outcome of a viral infection is determined by the nature of the virus, host interaction, and the host response to the infection. So here are the basic steps no, of viral diseases. So it starts with acquisition or the entry of the virus to the body, and it will end into resolution or persistent infection or chronic disease if left untreated. So here on the other side, it is the flow chart of how the virus, the stages of the viral infection rather. So A there, letter A, these are the stages no, of the viral infection. The virus are released from one person and is acquired by another, and then it replicates and then initiates a primary replication or primary infection at the site of acquisition. Depending on the virus, it may then spread to the entire body sites and finally target tissues. Characteristics of the disease. In B, this is the cycle where the cycle starts with acquisition as indicated and proceeds until the release of the new virus. So the thickness of the line class or the arrow there denotes the degree to which the original virus or inoculum is amplified or replicated. So the boxes there indicate the site or cause of symptoms. And the letter C, this is the time course of a viral infection. So the time course symptoms and the immune response class correlates the stage of viral infection and depend on whether the virus causes symptoms at the primary site or only after at the dissemination to another or the secondary site. So many viruses class interfere with the host cell function in ways that are harmful and pathological. So, this often results in changes in cell morphology, which referred to as cytopathic effects. However, pathogenesis class of the virus infection also involves inhibition of host cell gene expression. Thus, cytopathogenesis or pathogenesis class at cellular level is meant to be broader than the term cytopathic effects and includes other cellular changes that contribute to the viral pathogenesis in addition to those changes that are visible at microscopic level. So there are five potential outcomes of a viral infection of cell, and these are your failed infection or your abortive infection. So viral mutants class which do not multiply causes abortive infection and therefore disappear. Okay, another potential outcome class is cell death through or what we call as lytic infection. Lytic infections, on other hand, results when the virus replication class kills the target cell. So some viruses class damage the cell and prevent repair by inhibiting the synthesis of cellular macromolecules or by producing degradative enzymes and toxic proteins. Another potential outcome is replication without cell death or your persistent infection. So persistent infection occurs in an infected cell that is not killed by the virus. Some viruses causes persistent productive infection because the virus is released gently from the cell through exocytosis or through budding from the plasma membrane. Another potential outcome is replication without cell death but with immortalization of the cell. And last, presence of virus without virus production but with potential for reactivation or what we call as late recurrent infection. So latent infection may result from a DNA virus infection of a cell that restricts or locks the machinery for transcribing all viral genes, or the virus may encode the functions that suppress viral replications. Like for your for example, your cytomegalo viruses. So here, the table here shows the mechanism of viral cytopathogenesis, and their inclusion bodies. So some viral infection class cause cytolysis or characteristic changes in the appearance of properties of the target cell, which is called cytopathologic effect or your CPE. The effects of the cell may result as a viral takeover or macromolecular synthesis, accumulation of viral proteins or particles, or modification or even disruption of cellular structure or manipulation of cellular function. So for example, aberrations, no? Chromosomal aberrations and degradation may occur and can be detected with histologic staining. Okay, like for a histologic staining, for example, your HSV viruses. So this one here, this is an example of CPE or cytopathologic effects of HSV. So this is marginated chromatin ringing the nuclear membrane in HSV infected cell. So in addition, new sustainable structures called inclusion bodies may appear within the nucleus or cytoplasm. So these structures may result from a virus-induced changes in the membrane or chromosomal structure, or may represent the site of viral replication or accumulation of viral capsid. Because of the nature and location of these inclusion bodies or characteristics of particular infection, their presence facilitates laboratory diagnosis. Viral infections may also cause vacuolization, rounding of cells, and other non-specific histologic changes and characteristics of the cell. So for example, you have their Negri bodies, which is an intracytoplasmic inclusion bodies here. This is your, and your Cowdry, this is an intranuclear inclusion bodies, which is common in HSV, okay, or even measles. So please do familiarize the inclusion bodies, because this will give you class an idea later on what particular virus, okay, because this will also aid physicians physicians in diagnosing diseases. Aside from cytopathogenesis, the hypersensitivity and inflammatory reactions class initiated by antiviral immunity can be the major cause of pathologic manifestation and symptoms of the viral disease. So viral immunopathogenesis is also important class in knowing, no, viruses. So the early responses to the virus and viral infections like interferon or cytokines can initiate local inflammatory and systemic responses. So for example, interferon and cytokines stimulates flu-like symptoms, no, like fever, malaise, and what else? Headache, usually associated with respiratory syncytial viruses and even viremias. These symptoms during viremic stage often precedes the characteristic symptoms of the viral infection. So some viral infections induce large cytokines, like your cytokine storm, and these regulate immune responses and may trigger autoimmune diseases in genetically predisposed individual. So usually cytokine storm happens if there are enveloped viruses and other type of viruses. So for example, your coronaviruses, diba? A lot of cases are associated with cytokine storm. So the relative susceptibility class of a person and severity of the viral disease depends on the following factors. One is the mechanism of exposure and the site of infection, whether it's non-envelope or envelope type of viruses. So people class are usually exposed to viruses throughout their lives. However, some situations like lifestyle or even living arrangements class no increases the likelihood that a person will come contact with a certain virus. So many viruses class are ubiquitous in nature. So previous exposures like to HSV1, okay, your varicella zoster, which is the causative agent of your chickenpox, or Fibrovirus B19, and many respiratory or enteric viruses can be detected in most young people or children by early adulthood by the presence of antibodies of the virus. So, poor hygiene and overcrowded living school job condition promotes the exposure to respiratory and enteric viruses. Site of infection. Viruses class are transmitted via direct contact, including sexual contact, injection of contaminated fluids or blood, transplantation organs, and respiratory or fecal-oral route. Remember that the route of transmission class is dependent on the source of the virus. So, the tissue site of a viral replication and the secretion, and the ability of the virus to endure hazards and barriers of the environment and the body en route the target tissue. So, for example, viruses that replicates in the respiratory tract like your influenza viruses are released in aerosol, whereas enteric viruses class like your picorna and reverse are passed through fecal-oral route. So, non-envelope viruses can withstand drying, as I said, the effects of the detergent and extreme pH temperatures, whereas envelope viruses generally cannot. So these viruses class are generally transmitted through respiratory tract or fecal-oral route and can often be acquired from contaminated objects like fomites. So for example, your hepatitis A viruses, which is a picorna virus, and non-envelope viruses, okay, that is transmitted by fecal-oral route and acquired from a contaminated water, shellfish, or food. While most envelope viruses are comparatively fragile, so they require an intact envelope for infectivity. So these viruses must remain wet and spread via respiratory droplets, blood, mucus or semen, or via injection, or via organ transplantation. Most envelope viruses class are also liable to treatment with acid and detergent, which is a feature that precludes their being transmitted by fecal-oral route. Exceptions to the rule is your hepatitis B viruses and your coronaviruses. Another factors class is the immune status, okay? Immune status where people who are immunocompromised state as a result of AIDS, for that matter, cancer, and immunosuppressive therapy are at greater risk of suffering more serious disease on a primary infection and more prone to suffer recurrences of infection with latent viruses like herpes virus. Age also is another factor for susceptibility. So a person's age class is important factor in determining his or her susceptibility to viral infection. So, for example, infants, children, and adults, even elderly persons class are susceptible to different viruses and have different symptomatic responses to infection. So, for infants, are especially prone to more serious presentations of paramyxoviruses and viral gastroenteritis because of their small size and physiologic requirements. While your elderly naman class are especially susceptible to a new viral infection and reactivation of the latent virus. So for example, your shingles. because they are less able to initiate a new immune response, repair damaged tissue, and even recover. Elderly persons are therefore more susceptible to complication after infection and outbreak of the new strains of viruses. Like, for example, influenza A or even the COVID-19. Another factor is your viral dose and genetics of the virus and the host. Now let's go to laboratory diagnosis of your viral diseases. There have been many developments class in the laboratory viral diagnosis that provides more rapid, sensitive, and in determining viral clinical samples. So this includes better antibody reagents and more sensitive assays for direct analysis of samples. So why do we do viral laboratory studies? Viral laboratory studies class are performed to confirm diagnosis by identifying viral agent of infection, to determine appropriate antimicrobial therapy, to check on the compliance of the patient taking antiviral drugs, to define the course of the disease, to monitor the disease epidemiology, and to educate physician and patients. So, here are the most common class laboratory procedures done in diagnosing viral infection. You have cytologic examination, electron microscopy, virus isolation and growth, detection of viral proteins, detection of viral genomes, and even serology. So, before discussing the different steps, so here are the tables of the different specimens, okay, as treated with some common pathogenic viruses. So, selection and appropriate specimen class is dependent on the differential diagnosis for patient and the test to be performed. Take note that the specimens class should be collected early in the acute phase of infection before the virus ceases to shed. So, for example, respiratory viruses may shed for only 3 to 7 days and shedding may lapse before the symptoms cease. So, HSV, for that matter, and varicella zoster or viral DNA may not be recovered from lesions more than 5 days after the onset of infection. It may be possible to isolate an entire virus from CSF for only 2 to 3 days after the onset of central nervous system manifestation. In addition, antibody-produced response to the infections may block the detection of the virus. Okay, so this is also continuation to the previous table. So for enterovirus, you have their stool or CSF. For arbovirus, you can use stool. You can use blood, CSF. Okay. And for adenovirus and CMV, you can use urine. So, in conclusion class, the shorter the interval between the collection of the specimen and its delivery to the laboratory, the greater is the potential for isolating the virus. This is because many viruses class are labile and the samples are susceptible to bacterial and fungal overgrowth. So viruses are best transported and stored on ice, take note, and in special media that contains antibiotics and proteins such as serum albumin or gelatin. Again, for transportation of viral specimen class, it should be transported on ice and it should be place on a special media containing albumin or gelatin. Okay. Let's start with cytology. So many viruses class, as I said, produce a characteristic of cytopathologic effect or your CPE. Okay, characteristic CPEs in the tissue samples or cell culture include the changes in cell morphology, cell lysis, vacuolation, synctia, and even inclusion body. So synctia are multinucleated giant cells formed by viral fusions of individual cells like your paramyxo, HSV, varicella zoster, or even your HIV. Okay. So, inclusion bodies are either histologic changes in the cell caused by viral components or virus-induced changes in the cell structure. So, for example, intranuclear basophilic inclusion bodies or your ALS-I, which is found in your CMV, and your rabies inclusion bodies, which is your Negri bodies, which are detected using your brain tissue. Okay? This one, picture above class, is a synctium formation by measles virus. This is a multinucleated giant cell visible in a histologic section of a lung biopsy from a measles virus-induced giant cell pneumonia in an immunocompromised child. This one here, this is a herpes simplex virus-induced cytopathologic effect. This is a biopsy specimen of HSV-infected liver. Shows an eosinophilic Caudry type A. So this one here is a surrounded by halo and a ring marginated chromatin at the nuclear membrane. And this one, is an infected cell exhibit a smaller condensed nucleus. So usually, the nucleus is known to be pycnotic type of nucleus. At the bottom, okay, this is a Negri bodies caused by your rabies. So, this is a section of brain from a patient with rabies. Here is a higher magnification of another biopsy, and this is also your Negri bodies class. Electron microscopy. For electron microscopy, it is not a standard clinical laboratory technique, but it can be used to detect and identify some viruses. If sufficient, viral particles are present. The addition of the virus-specific antibodies to sample can cause viral particles to clump, thereby facilitating the detection and simultaneous identification of the virus. Like for example, your immune electron microscopy. Enteric viruses like rotavirus that are produced in abundance and have characteristic morphology can be detected in stool by this method. So this is an example of your rotavirus and using electron microscopy. Appropriately processed tissue from biopsy or clinical specimen can also be examined for the presence of viral structure using this type of method. Okay, so for viral isolation and growth, isolation of the virus allows subsequent analysis and archiving of samples but may put personnel at risk for infection. So a virus class can be grown in tissue culture, embryonated eggs, and even experimental animals. So although embryonated eggs are still used for the growth, no? Of viruses for some vaccines like influenza, they have been replaced by cell culture for routine isolation in clinical laboratories. So experimental animals are rarely used in clinical laboratories for isolating viruses. So the most common class is your tissue culture. So tissue culture, we can use primary cell line, diploid cell line, or tumor or immortalized cell line. So primary cell cultures are obtained by dissociating specific animal organs with trypsin or collagenase. The cells then obtained by these methods are then grown as monolayers or organoids or in suspension like your lymphocytes in artificial media supplemented with bovine serum or another source of growth factors. So primary cells can be dissociated and allowed to grow into a new monolayer to become a secondary cell culture. So common example for primary cell culture is your monkey kidney cells used to isolate, okay, your influenza virus. Your diploid cell lines are cultures of a single type that are capable of being passed as a large but finite number of times before the senescence or undergo a significant change in their characteristics. So, common example, you have your pyroblastic cells used to culture HSV, VCV, and CMV. And lastly, your tumor or immortalized cell line, usually NSH-ed from human or animal tumors, or by treatment of primary cells with oncogenic virus or chemicals, consists of single cell types that can be passed continuously without senescing. So, example, you have your HeLa cells used to culture your respiratory syncytial virus and even your herpes simplex virus. So, for viral detection, a virus can be detected and initially identified through observation of the virus-induced CPE in the cell monolayer by immunofluorescence or by genome analysis of the infected cell culture. A plaque is formed when a single infects and spreads and kills surrounding cells. The type of cell culture characteristics of the CPE and the rapidly and viral growth can be used initially to identify many clinically important viruses. So this approach to identifying viruses is similar to that used in the identification of bacteria, which is based on the growth and morphology class of the colonies on selected culture media. So here, this is an HSV-1 infected virus cell. Okay. Showing rounded cell, multinucleated cell, and loss of monolayers. So the arrow there points class on the syncytial formation. Some viruses also grow slowly or not all do not readily cause CPE in cell lines, typically used in clinical virology laboratories. So some viruses cause disease that are hazardous to personnel. These viruses are not cultured but diagnosed on the basis of serologic findings or through detection of viral genomes or proteins. So for example, class, your rubella. Rubella may not cause CPE, but it does prevent the replication of picornavirus in a process known as heterologous inference, which can be used to detect rubella virus. Cells infected with influenza virus, parainfluenza virus, mumps virus, and toga virus express a viral glycoprotein, hemagglutinin, that binds erythrocytes of defined animal species to infected cells. And we use the process of hemadsorption to that. When released into the cell of the culture medium, such virus can be detected by agglutination of erythrocytes, which the process of hemagglutination. The virus can then be identified from the specific antibodies that blocks hemagglutination, which is the process called hemagglutination inhibition test or your HI test. Here at the bottom class, this is an hemadsorption of erythrocytes to the cell infected with influenza virus, mumps, parainfluenza virus, or toga virus. These viruses appears a hemagglutinin on their surface, which binds erythrocytes of the selected animals. So, this table shows you the different assays for viral proteins and nucleic acid. So, the genetic sequence of a virus class is a major distinguishing characteristics of the family, type, and strains of the virus. So, sequence specific genetic probes, genomes, amplification techniques, and even your next genome sequencing class techniques allows rapid detection, identification, and quantitation with the minimum risk from infectious virus. So, viral enzymes class and proteins are produced during viral replication and can be detected by biochemical, immunologic, and molecular biological means. So the viral proteins can be separated by electrophoresis and their pattern used to identify or distinguish different viruses. So for example, the electrophoresis separated HSV-infected cell proteins and the variant proteins exhibit different patterns for different type of strains of HSV-1 and HSV-2. For many laboratories class, the method of choice for detection, quantification, and identification of the viruses, it uses genome amplification techniques including your PCR for DNA genomes and reverse transcriptase PCR for RNA genomes and real-time PCR for the identification and quantification of RNA or DNA type of viruses. Use of appropriate primers for PCR can promote million-fold amplification of target sequence in few hours. So this technique is especially useful for detecting latent and integrated sequence of the virus such as retrovirus, herpes virus, and even papilloma virus. The RT-PCR class uses retroviral reverse transcriptase to convert RNA, viral RNA to DNA and allow PCR amplification of the viral nucleic acid sequences. So newly automated systems class are available to analyze panel of microbes from a multiple samples. So this system process samples concentrate the genomic sequence simultaneously and amplify the genomes for different microbes in a multiplex way. So common examples, you have a respiratory panel that detects 17 virus and 3 bacteria. So these are being done in some laboratories nowadays. So instead of culturing, if the doctor suspected for a respiratory type of viruses, commonly they requested a respiratory panel. And in that respiratory panel, it contains series of genomic sequences for both viruses and bacteria. So viral serology, humoral immune response class provides history of patient infection. So serologic studies are used for the identification of a virus that are difficult to isolate and grown in culture, like your Epstein-Barr virus, your hepatitis B virus, and even your HIV. Serology can use to identify a virus and its strain or serotype, whether it's an acute or chronic disease, and determines whether it's primary infection or reinfection. So these are the different viruses that are diagnosed by serology. So what are the examples of serologic assays? So the serologic test can be used in virology. Common, you have the neutralization and the hemagglutination inhibition test assay, in which the antibody coating of the virus class blocks the binding to the indicator cells and subsequent infection. For hemagglutination inhibition, the antibody in the patient's serum prevents a standardized amount of the virus from binding to and agglutinating the agglutinating erythrocytes. The indirect and direct immunofluorescence and your ELISA assays are commonly used to detect and quantitate viral antigen and antiviral antibodies. ELISA also class are used to screen blood supply to exclude individuals who are seropositive for hepatitis B and C and even HIV. The Western blot analysis can also be used to determine specific proteins recognized by patient serum and was used to confirm seroconversion and hence infection with HIV. So that's the end of the first part of the discussion. So here are the references that I use in making this presentation. So you can read these two books for further understanding on the topics that I had discussed a while ago. So if you have questions, feel free to email me and ask, if you have questions. Thank you and have a great day.